H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys supports 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus. One-time pay, lifetime access to live classes and videos. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For free demo class, visit h2kinfosys.com.
Now, coming to it, if I comment the try block and comment the catch block and comment these parts also, then you will see that it is executing this line has a problem, so it will execute these lines, the compiler will execute. This line has a problem, the compiler will stop out here and will not get the result of G now. If you remove the try catch block or comment the try catch block, and that is what is happening out here. You're getting the value of C only, which is 50. You're not getting the value of D. That is B divided by A. You're getting it down somewhere. Here it, you are getting it. And you can actually make it better by just giving a simple sysout. This will create a blank line and your console result will be better. So if I run the class file after saving, this gives you and you can also put a blank line. You should put it actually above it, two blank lines, so that you can look at the console result in a better format. This is now better. So you're getting these two and then you're getting the exception out. And if you include the try catch block, it will handle the exception. After handling the exception in line number, right now line number is 17, the compiler will move the control to the catch block and execute the body of the catch block. The body of the catch block is out here. And after executing the body, it will print out the value of G also. So this is how we get. This is the body of the catch block, one part of the body. This is nothing but the print stack trace. This is nothing but the get message method result, and this is the result of G. If you want to get a better result in the console, again you use a sysout, simple println command out here to create some space, and this is how you're getting it. Okay, so this is how you can handle exceptions. The third part of the example will be some types of unchecked exceptions. So we'll see that. So I'll create a new class file, and that class file can be called as types unchecked exceptions. Call the main method. So we have already seen one kind of unchecked exception, that is divide by zero. Okay, so that is your arithmetic exception. So I will again formulate that process of creating the arithmetic exception out here. So A, let's say, is equal to 90 divided by zero. So what is going to happen? This is going to show you, I will call the value of A. So obviously this is going to throw out an unchecked exception, and the type of exception will be your arithmetic exception. You can see that, and this is the message, and the line number which has the exception is line number 7. That is what is getting highlighted. So this is one part of exception. If I write any lines of code below it, that will not get executed because, and that will not be read by the compiler because line number 7 already has an exception. So what I need to do is that I can use the try catch block to handle it. So this is the try block. This is the body of this try block starting, and then you can put a tab, and this is the end of the try block, and the try block is always followed by a catch block because these two are in player, and then you can have the catch block body, and here you can pass on the object of the exception class, let's say E, and I can get the, this is heavily used, print stack trace. This particular method is heavily used to get the origin of the exception, and the next thing that you can use is the get message of the exception using the e dot get message method. Okay, and if I run this, it will handle the exception in these lines. Okay, and move the control to the catch block, execute the body part of the catch block. So if I run the class file at this point of time, it will show you this is nothing but part of your print stack trace. And this is nothing but your the get message method used inside the catch block. This is how you can handle a arithmetic exception. So I want to show you other exception in this particular class file, and that is why I handle it with the try catch block. The other exceptions that I want to show you is something known as, so this is an example of your arithmetic exception, which is an unchecked exception. And that is why if I want to show you any other exceptions, I need to be handling this arithmetic exceptions coming out in line number 10 right now. Because anything divided by 0 is infinity, and compiler of Java will throw you the result as an unchecked exception, and it will be called as arithmetic. Now I want to show an example of array index out of bound exception, and this is also a example of unchecked exceptions. Now let's give you a heads up. All these unchecked exceptions, how does the compiler know that this line will throw an arithmetic exception? Or how does the compiler know that it has to throw out this particular exception? Because these exceptions are already defined in the compiler of your JVM. Okay, so how do you get an unchecked exception, which is an array index out of bound exception? So let's say I define an array. So I'll define, let's say, a string type array. A two-dimensional string type array, and this is how the array should be declared, array string. And let's say I need to declare the number of rows and columns. The number of rows, let's say, is 2, and number of columns is 2. Then after that, the next thing that I need to do is define data for the first row. So how do I define it? The variable s is a string array. So s, so let's say the first row is given by index number 0 and the first column by index number 0. And this should be of string type. Let's say this is Sam. And this particular first row, first column is given by index number 0 and 0 respectively. And this is nothing but the, let's say, the first name. Okay. And now, next thing that I need to do is I define the first row defined by index number 0 and first column. First row, second column, because there are two columns out here. First row, second column is defined by index number 1. And let's say this defines the last name. And by mistake, I give, this is a carelessness from the coding side, it gives the age of that particular person. And this define, let's say, the age. And this is first row, third column, define my index number 2. If you see the compiler, it does not show any kind of problem because you have defined only 2 rows and 2 columns. How can you define the third column for the first row? So this is nothing but a carelessness mistake, but the compiler does not show you that there's a problem in this line number 23. So along like this, I also define, let's say, data for the second row. And second row is nothing but defined by index number 1 and column number 1. Let's say this is mark. Second row, second column is this. Let's say mark Anthony. And by mistake, it also defines the coder also defines the result for second row, third column, whose age is equal to 50 or 30, let's say example. Okay. Now, there's no problem until this time because the compiler does not show any kind of problem in any of the lines. Okay, I use a for loop to get the results of all the data in this particular array. So the for loop defines, first of all, the index number, the outer for loop defines the index number of the row. Index number starts with 0 and r should be less than s dot length. And s plus plus, the outer for loop is for the rows. Sorry, r plus plus. The inner for loop defines the column in each row. So I would define the index number for the column with c is equal to 0, for example. And c should be less than s of 0 dot length. This is how you get the column size. And then c plus plus. And I want to get the values. So I can write down a SISO and call up the variable s and define the indexes for the row defined by r and indexes of the column defined by c. Now let us run this class file. There's no harm in running this class file because the compiler does not show any syntax error. So let's say I save this class file and run it. Okay, this part is coming for the exception handling out there. So if I actually comment these parts, I will not get anything. I will just get the exception that is coming in line number 23 right now. And this is the message of the exception. And this is the type of exception. It is array index out of bound. What is the message? It is saying that index number cannot be 2. And it is in line number 23. It is saying that you have defined only 2 rows and 2 columns. How can you define the third column for the first row out there? That is why, that means the indexing has been not been done properly. That is why it is showing you the problem is in line number 23. Now if I comment it and again run this, I'll see that the index number array index out of bound again is coming, and the message of the exception is line, that is index number 2, and the line number is now 28. That means this one, this is correct now because I've commented it, but this is also not correct because you do not have the third column because you have defined number of columns equal to 2 out here. How can you give you the third column? If I comment it, I can run it, then the exception will not come. I'll get the result for all the data present in this particular array. But let's say there's a mistake out here, obviously. So what is going to happen? And I uncomment these parts also, which is nothing but the body part of the catch block for the this particular exception. So if I run this, I'll get, you know, this is the part. So I'll get, first of all, this is coming out for the cache method block having the print stack trace message, and this is the get message method result defined in the cache block of your arithmetic exception. And this is the exception coming out for the lines of code, which is nothing but these lines of code. Okay, so this is the exception thrown out, and what is the exception? It's called array index out of bound, and the index number having a problem is 2. That is what is thrown by the message of the exception, and the line number is 23. So if I click on that, this is the line number. So this is another example of your unchecked exception, because it is thrown out in the console of Eclipse after the class file is run. So now I need to handle it, because if I write down any codes below F for loop, this is a for loop. Let's say I have a code, let's say integer g is equal to 20. And I want to get the result of this particular code. If let's understand that this code is important. So g. So at this point of time, I'll not get the value of g equal to 20, because line number 23 has a problem with the index number. Array index is becoming out of bound, out of boundary rather. That is why I'm not getting the value of g. Now let's say I handle the exception. So how do I handle it? I know these lines of code has a problem. All these lines of code will have a problem, and obviously this for loop will also not work. So what I will do is that precisely I can put a try block out here. Okay, or at least get the result. What I can do is that I can put a try block for this line. This line has a problem. Okay, so I put a try block, and try block is obviously followed by the catch block, and then you have the parenthesis of the catch block, and then you have pass on the exception e out there, and this line also has a problem. So what I will do is that I'll put this also under the try block. And this line also has a problem. Put it under the try block. The try block is always followed by the catch block, because these are in pairs. And pass on the object of the exception e out here again. And if I want to, I can basically get the result at least, or get message of the exception, and that how I get it, sys out e dot get message. If you want to get the stack trace also, you'll get the stack trace, just e dot print stack trace. The same thing is possible with this particular catch block body. So what is going to happen? It is going to handle this part. The exception is going to handle by the try catch part. So this line will be handled, and what is going to happen? The compiler will move to the catch block, execute the body of the catch block, and execute the for loop, and then execute the value of g out here. So let us run this now. This is coming for the arithmetic exception, print stack trace method present in the catch block of arithmetic exception. This is the message of the exception divided by zero, and this two is for the get message method present inside the try catch block out here. And then you have a print stack trace, that is why you are getting this part. Array index out of bound, you can see that. Okay, and then the compiler will execute these lines, and then there's a try block. The compiler will understand this is as an unchecked exception. Execute the catch block body, that is what it has done. First the get message method, that is this one, and then the print stack trace, which is given by these lines. Print stack trace is going to print out the type of exception, the message of the exception, and the line number which has a problem, which is going to help out in a long run. And then it executes the for loop. Now if you see the for loop out here, the result of the for loop is nothing but Sam, Mendes, Mark, and Anthony. And then it executes the g also, the variable g, and that is what you get out here. This is how you can actually handle exceptions and you get the results of the codes which are below the line, below the code in which the exception is present. This is another example of your unchecked exception, that is array index out of bound. The third example that I'm going to give is an example of null pointer exception. So null pointer exception, let's say I define the same I define a variable, let's say str. I define it equal to null. And I define the first row. Let's say I define these row. The details can be same. Only thing that needs to be changed is the variable is str, and this is str, and I can change the values also of this. Let's say Peter, Charles, and define the data of the second row. The variables are str and str out here, and this can be, let's say, called is as John McEnroe. And I use the same for loop to get the result.